1776 was an important year. That year, life as we know it changed. The foundations of a whole new way of thinking was developed. The world would not be the same. That is the year that Adam Smith wrote An Inquiry into the Nature and Cause of the Wealth of Nations, referred to as The Wealth of Nations. Adam Smith, a Scottish philosopher, organized his thoughts in what would become known as the foundation of economics. In the book, he tried to explain what was happening around the world and with respect to industrial revolution. Things like division of labor, how prices are determined, production processes. Since then, economists have tried to explain many of the things we see around us. The growth theory we are discussing evolved after World War II, sparked by the inquiry of an economist called Robert Solow, developed in 1950s. His model is going to be the basis in which we introduce the other models of growth. The first building block is to define how countries produce. We will define what we call the production function. The production function describes the relationship between inputs that are used to produce and the output that they create. We're simplifying the complexity of life by saying that to produce outputs, we need inputs. The production function can be that of any entity that takes inputs and turns them into outputs. It can be a country, a firm, a household, or an individual. It is hard for some to think of themselves as having a production function, but think about it. You as an individual take resources and turn them into output. If you work, you do this at work. If you're studying, you also have a student production function. Your inputs can be summarized in the form of physical capital, human capital. In the context of a country, inputs are summarized as physical capital, human capital, and natural resources. And the output is GDP. We can abbreviate it as GDP is a function of K, which is what we're going to represent physical capital with. HK represents the amount of human capital. This is how we simplify our country's production. The first version of the Solow growth model focused on capital as the reason for growth. And the reason that Solow focused on this is because Solow believed it is easy to increase tools available to a country and to increase output per worker. And what Solow also realized by looking at real-world observations is that capital in wealthy nations exceeds capital in developing nations. He concluded that capital is the reason why countries vary in their growth rates. Also, he recognized using data that the periods where investment grew, and remember, we use investment to increase our capital, are usually periods of expansion. Therefore, he found this relationship between investment and growth. And here's the plot. We're looking at investment growth and how correlated it is with GDP growth. But the problem is, we don't want to get correlation mixed up with causation. Just because two things are related does not mean that one of them is causing the other. In this example, on the x-axis, we have the growth rate of investment in real terms. On the y-axis, we have the growth rate of GDP in real terms. And what we find is that there is a positive relationship. When investment growth rate is positive, the growth rate in GDP is positive as well. And it's easy for us to say investment then is causing real GDP growth. But that is not what this graph is saying. The graph is saying that the two are related. So what we need is a model to help explain why investment would actually lead to economic growth. What Solow did is develop this production function to help explain and started to ask the question, if we increase physical capital, what will happen to output? He was interested in this concept that we now call the marginal product of an input. Specifically, he was interested in the marginal product of capital. He was interested in knowing what is the return on capital if we add one additional unit. In the example of a country, if we added one more unit of capital, what would that unit of capital yield us in the form of increased GDP? Mathematically, this can be calculated as the change in output divided by the change in input. And the input in this example would be capital. What we expect is marginal product is positive. As we add more capital, it's going to lead to an increase in output. However, the marginal product is not constant. As we add more inputs, it leads to increase in output, but each additional input is not producing as much as the previous unit of input. And to do that, we plot the production function as such. On the x-axis, we're going to have capital. On the y-axis, we're going to have output, or GDP. To help process the idea of the production functions, let us apply it to the student perspective. I want you to think about it from your own personal standpoint. Let's say that you are studying for economics, and you want to do really well, and your output for this course is going to be your grade. For inputs, you have human capital, which is your talents and your time. For physical capital, you have the number of computers or other physical resources that you might use. These are all parts of the production function. These are all inputs that are available to you. Remember that Solow growth model, though, focuses on capital specifically as the method to increase output. So it holds constant the amount of studying that you're actually doing. And it says, can we give students more physical capital, let's say computers, and can we increase their grade? So let's say a student starts with zero computers. How easy is it for them to learn in this class? It's going to be really difficult. Their grade is not going to be as high. They're probably going to rely on their natural abilities only, or their human capital. Let's say that without a computer, the score would be 60 out of 100. As we give a student that first computer is going to help access class resources. It's going to help students participate in class discussion. They will be able to watch the videos for the course, and therefore it's going to increase their grade, let's say by 20 points. With one computer, students are going to earn a grade of 80. Now, what if that student received a second computer? What is the marginal product of that second computer? What is the change to the grade that that second computer provides? We know the first computer provided 20 percentage points. The second computer is not going to add 20 percentage points. Is there a benefit of having a second computer? Yes. You might find that having a second computer allows you to use each computer in a different way to enhance your learning. I, for instance, benefit from having different apps and screens running when I study. But the additional gain of a second computer won't be as large as the gain from the first computer. It might increase my grade by, let's say, 10 percentage points. Therefore, the marginal product of the first computer was 20 points, but the marginal product of the second computer is only 10. This is what we call diminishing marginal productivity, or diminishing marginal product. It is the concept that additional units of capital will add to your output, but each additional unit will provide a lower change. And this has implications, because as we continue to give you, for instance, more computers, it's not going to lead to an increase in output as much as you had anticipated. Applying this model to countries means that a country can increase its output by increasing capital, but eventually gains from additional capital will be negligible. This introduces two hypotheses that are derived from the Solow model. The first one is this concept called steady state. The second one is a concept called convergence. We'll go through these in a little bit more detail. Steady state is the state of a macroeconomy where there's no new net investment. And the reason there's no new net investment is because one downfall of capital is capital depreciates. As an economy grows, its capital stock will get to the point where it's necessary to reinvest some of the money to replace depreciating capital. And as your capital stock increases, depreciation takes up a bigger part of your budget. And if you're not increasing your investment at higher rates, then your investment budget will be dedicated only to replacing capital that has depreciated. In a steady state economy, all investment is allocated to replacing depreciating capital. So there's no new net investment. and no growth in capital. And that's what we mean by an economy that has reached steady state. The only way to get out of the steady state is to increase your investment rate, which we know from our discussions about loanable funds market requires an increase in savings rates. The other way to go around it is to find ways to minimize depreciation. Those are the only ways for the economy to grow after reaching steady state. The other idea that comes out of the Solow growth model is this concept of convergence. Convergence is the idea that per capita GDP across nations will eventually equalize. As nations approach their steady state, smaller economies will eventually catch up to the richer economies. That's because marginal product of capital is high for countries with low capital. Therefore, their growth rates will be higher. As rich economies reach their steady state, less developed economies will be able to catch up with them. The hypothesis here then is less developed countries should have higher growth rates than rich countries. Solow developed these models to help explain some of the real-world observations at that time, and he was able to impact policies. We saw governments start to invest heavily in capital infrastructures to increase GDP, but the model didn't fully explain the world. When economists went back and looked at the data, they saw that growth in wealthy nations still outpaced poor countries. There was no sign of catch-up. There's no sign of convergence. The gap between rich and poor countries is actually widening. So evidence for the Solow growth model wasn't strong. Looking at the development policies of the 1950s, policymakers wanted to increase country production or GDP by giving less developed areas more capital. And the production function in this example shows us that as we increase our capital, it might not lead to an equivalent increase in output. And that's how economies then start to struggle to grow, because they've exhausted all the returns from capital. For a while there, this is the policy that a lot of countries implemented. Let's grow the economy by increasing capital. And in the beginning, when you go from having no capital to some capital, there are benefits, and they are high. Initial experiment looked promising. Eventually, as policies were scaled and we started running into the problem that the production function, as we increased capital, led to lower returns than we had anticipated. Solow growth model then, in summary, is that capital appears to cause economic growth. Because of the observed strong correlation between capital and output, it was assumed that workers are more productive with more tools. However, we learned that capital alone is not enough to explain sustained economic growth. Growth eventually fizzles with additional capital due to diminishing marginal productivity. Also, the rich kept on getting richer, and it wasn't due to capital. Economists needed to find more evidence or update the Solow growth model to explain the reality of economic growth that we are observing. In the next video, we'll talk about how economists modified the Solow growth model.